Welcome everyone to this Facebook Live session with International IDEA. My name is Lisa Hagman. I work in the communications team. And together with me today is Yukihiko Hamada from our PPR team, Political Participation and Representation.
That's right.
Yes. I want to invite everyone who's watching, add your comments, questions in the field under the live stream. We will try and get back to you as soon as we can. We will today also talk about one of our databases, and we'll make sure to put the link directly under the live feed so that you know how you have an easy access point to the database. Today we're going to talk about money and
yes.
money in politics. Yuki, why don't you start a little bit? Just describe yourself and the team.
Absolutely. Thank you, Lisa. So my name is Yuki Hamada. As Lisa mentioned, I work as a senior program officer in political participation and representation team here at IDEA headquarters in Stockholm. So my team has been working on the issue of money in politics for a number of years. Practically, I mean, we also work on the issues of political finance regulations, how one country adapting and then also supporting the countries reform their political finance regulations. But we also look at issues controlling illicit flow of money, as well as looking at other risk areas when it comes to money in politics, such as emerging trends of cryptocurrencies in political finance, for example.
Yes. And if we're talking about illicit money, we actually did a Facebook Live not so long ago. So if you're interested in that topic and how that relates to political parties and participation, you go back to International IDEA's YouTube stream and you'll find it there.
Please, that was a very interesting one too.
But let's go back to the basics.
Yes.
Why does money in politics matter?
Exactly. It matters both positively and negatively. And of course, let's start with the positives. Of course, money is an important aspect of any democracies. We acknowledge that political parties and candidates, they do need financial resources to successfully run their campaigns and be elected. And of course, money, from citizens' point of view as well, any donations that they make is also a way of expressing their political support to a particular political party or candidate. So in this sense, money is an integral part of any electoral process, I would say. But however, we also recognize that if the money, the flow of money into campaigns to political parties is not appropriately regulated, those with bigger financial powers or private sectors or anyone with a much bigger financial resources could dominate such campaigns or cast a huge influence over political parties and candidates, and this will inevitably undermine the integrity of political participation and representation. So therefore, we believe the appropriate level of regulation of money in politics is crucial, and that's something we've been working on.
Okay, yeah, this is very interesting. Just concretely, what IDEA is working on, No, you want to talk about the political finance database because it's just been
Absolutely.
Updated. Could you talk, what is it and what was the rationale behind the updates?
Thank you. So this database that I'm going to talk about is called Political Finance Database. It was first launched in 2003. So it's been around the block for quite some time. It started with a demand from countries and other electoral management bodies that they often know what's happening in their own countries. But however, when it comes to looking for the other good practices or what other countries are doing when it comes to regulating politics, there is a very severe lack of resources data. So they don't necessarily know how to compare themselves to other countries. So then IDEA undertook this quite a big project and then start collecting information about a number of countries' political finance regulations and then put them all together. That's how we started. But of course, political finance regulations, similar to any laws, changing quite rapidly, and then also landscape surrounding the issue of money in politics is also changing. So we periodically conduct update of the database as well, and the most recent update was in 2016, and then it's been 2 years, obviously, exactly. So we this time around we managed to increase the number of questions to 74 questions, and managed to increase the number of countries included as well. So I'm happy to announce that 2018 update, we currently have 74 questions for 180 countries, which I believe made this database is one of the richest source of information for those interested in money in politics.
Yeah. You mentioned that this is a field that it's changing quite rapidly, and that countries have a need to actually know what other countries are doing. But I guess you also have researchers. And for them, they like to see trends. Can you do this with this new update?
Absolutely. This is one of the added feature on 2018 version of the database. So users or researchers, exactly, for anyone who's interested in money in politics, they could actually compare the 2016 data and then 2018 data. So in some cases, countries have changed their political finance regulation in the last 2 years, and that itself is a very interesting findings. But also in some cases, you can also see some shortcomings still remain in the last 2 years. So even if you do not see the changes, that tells quite some stories as well. So that's quite an interesting feature.
Could you say something, sort of, what are the questions, what does the database cover? It's a big field?
Exactly, and I said 74 questions, that's a huge number of questions. But we, just to introduce some structure into this, we broadly categorize those questions into four pillars, four categories. One is about public funding. So we look into the ways how countries distribute state funding, state resources to political parties. That means, what are the criteria, or in the first place, do a country provide such public funding to political parties, and so forth. Then second category is about regulations concerning the private donations. So that's political party allowed to receive political donations from private sources. But what are the private sources? So we look also into details, if there's a regulation on donation from anonymous sources or foreign sources, or how about companies with state ownership, for example. So that's the second pillar. And then third pillar is about the regulation on spending. So we have a number of questions relating to whether there's a spending cap and spending limits, and for example. And then the last category is about the oversight.
Who is checking on political parties,
exactly,
or sort of if there is someone checking political parties. For those who just joined, let me just recap that I'm sitting here today with Yuki, and we're talking about money in politics, and more in detail about international ideas, knowledge resources, publications, and the database that we have. So you talked about the four pillars.
Yes.
Could you say something then, sort of more in detail?
Happy to.
What have you found when it comes to public funding?
Exactly. So the public funding is the first thing probably political parties or electoral management bodies think about when they think about political finance, because it is a growing trend, and then also it is a major pillar to ensure that that playing field is actually leveled. In that sense, by providing public funding, most political parties, regardless of their size or the history, whether they've been established for long or not, have some type of financial resources to start with. So we believe that this is a very good practice to have, and then are encouraging countries to consider developing public funding system to make sure that political representation is accessed equally. But the very interesting fact that our new database found is actually 68% of the countries that we surveyed have such a public funding system at the moment, which is encouraging. But of course, the flip side of the coin is that the 32% of the countries do not have public funding. This means that political parties and candidates in those countries have to 100% rely on the private funding.
Yeah, and we'll talk a little bit more about private funding soon. But I know that you're a bit excited, and I know there's a book about how you can use public funding to increase women's political participation or representation.
Representation.
Actually. Yeah.
Exactly. So thank you for bringing this up. Because one of the perks of having public funding is that it has a very good secondary objective as well. So of course, the primary, we're thinking about providing the minimum financial resources to political parties. But for example, if we design the public funding in certain ways, we could certainly address other problems in politics as well. And as you mentioned, one of the persisting problems in politics is the gender inequality, females underrepresentations in politics. And we believe by ear tagging, for example, the public funding to promoting gender-related activities, or making sure that criteria for receiving public funding to be linked to the number of female candidates nominated by apolitical parties, for example. Political parties have more incentive, more financial incentive to include female candidates in their electoral list, for example. And then we believe that's been working in some countries. And then we actually devoted the time and then produced a standalone report here, Gender Target Public Funding for Political Parties, which was just published in 2018 as well. And this includes a number of country case studies. And according to our database, to the best of knowledge, currently about 15% of the countries surveyed in the database have already such provisions in
place.
And how
many is that, 15%?
That's about 30 countries.
Okay.
But then also this report says, it may not sound a large volume just yet, but the number has been increasing. So in the years to come, we believe this number will even go up.
And this is quite interesting because I think the sort of earlier findings of IDEA's research show that one of the reasons, there are many reasons why women don't have the same possibilities to be elected, but one is lack of resources.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So this is one way of actually overcoming that obstacle
is
by using public funding.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, so we talked about public funding.
Yeah.
And then we have the other big issue, private funding.
Absolutely.
what has changed?
Exactly. So to start with, International IDEA takes a stance that private funding is not always bad. We always acknowledge that this is a very important part of the for citizens to express their political will. So therefore, we do not advocate to regulate everything or even ban every donation, so to say. But however, increasingly in the recent years as well, we see a lot of scandals, for example, political parties receiving a huge amount of donations from questionable sources or sometimes anonymous donations. And citizens also demand transparency and accountability. So therefore, in this respect, we like to see countries moving towards more transparent and better regulated public private funding scheme. And just as an example, for example, recently in New Zealand, a politician actually received a very huge amount of donations from a business person. And that triggered a bit of the controversy and then also the reform debate, for example, from what sources a political party or political or candidate receive a donation, for example, or to how much, to what extent do they need to disclose the identity of donor, for example.
And you told me when we prepared for this, in some countries there is nothing to ban a donation from a foreign country.
For example, exactly. So to answer your questions, according to the database we have, over 30% of surveyed countries currently do not have regulations when it comes to donations from foreign sources. And the same number of countries do not have regulations on anonymous donations either.
Okay, this is very interesting. Have you seen any regional trends? Can you see sort of this is just happening in one region or?
No, interestingly, this is actually happening everywhere, from established democracies to newly born democracies. So really from Europe to Africa to Latin America to Asia Pacific, there are countries who have regulations on these issues, but there are also equally countries that do not have regulations.
Okay, interesting that it's a spread. Mm. Okay, so we talked about the income side of political parties and money in politics. Are there other regulatory trends that you can see?
Absolutely, any regulation on money in politics has to have two sides. At least one is on regulation on income side, as you mentioned, and then the other regulation needs to be on the spending side. So that means political parties and candidates are required to disclose how they spend the money they receive. And this is also in the interest of the in the general public, and also the media, and then also the civil CSOs that are interested in the political matters. And it's very interesting to see that, of course, we take this for granted, but currently, according to the database, 77% of the countries do require political parties to submit their financial reports at some point of their electoral cycle. Although this is a majority of countries, but if you also think about 23% of the countries, there's no provision requiring political parties to submit their financial report, which is definitely something that we need to work on and then countries to consider regulating in. And then, of course, even within the 77% of the countries I just mentioned, there's a wide variety when it comes to the forms and then modalities of disclosure and reporting. In some countries, political parties submit their financial forms in paper format, for example. In more advanced versions, other countries, they have systems to do so online through their digital platform. And then, of course, in this modern age, we certainly like to encourage countries to move from the paper-based or analog system to more advanced ICT digital platform to allow political parties to report and then disclose political finance. This is not just because being fancy. This has a number of benefits by using the ICT and digital disclosures. One is obviously it will eliminate human errors significantly, of course, when you do it in paper and pen. Even if you do not intend to, it could be easily create some type of human errors, and then the risk will be significantly reduced if you use online technologies, of course. And then, of course, and the efficiency and then speed as well. This will significantly improve then by using the ICT technologies. And then also from user perspectives, if you do so online, it will be much easier when it comes to disclose such information. Users can, for example, download such information and then use it for their own research, for example. Or they could search or filter so that they can just easily find the information that they're interested without going through the hundreds of files. Exactly, can you imagine? So really, I think there are a lot of benefits, and we like to think that this is a very modern solution to a lot of problems surrounding the transparency and then disclosure. And then on that note, again, we're also happy to announce that we actually been working on this issue for quite some years. And aside this database, we also produced a new guide, so-called Digital Solutions for Political Reporting and Disclosure.
Which we happen to have here.
Exactly. It's been also a year, and it has been proved to be a very useful source of information for any countries or any political parties or electoral managers. management bodies who are thinking developing such a platform. The good thing about this guide is that it includes a very detailed, concrete, step-by-step instructions and recommendations for developing such systems. So it, for anyone, for at whatever stage, even if you may not even thought about this, but this will help conceptualizing the digital disclosure. Or even if you have a system, but if you're thinking about updating it, this also provides some concrete recommendations to make it even better, more user-friendly source of web. So I think this covers a very wide range of audience, and then certainly we encourage the viewers to have a look if they have a chance.
Sounds very good. Also, because I think everyone knows that any big ICT project costs a lot of money. So absolutely, anything that can be done to facilitate that, exactly, that process is of course useful. When it comes, you talked about the expenditure side then. You mentioned that the fourth pillar in the database is oversight.
Exactly.
Yes. Could you expand a little bit on the new findings?
Exactly. So there's a oversight is it's very important, and then that's the cornerstone. That's the last part of the oversight. And then when it comes to what needs to be oversight, that's slightly linked to the regulatory trends of income part as well. But for example, what needs to be reported, for example, that's very important. And then when it comes to, so I'm sliding back and forth between the, you know, spending and then how oversight needs to be conducted on spending. We find that placing, so for example, spending limits on some of the issues is very important as well. And then, for example, currently 32% of the countries that are surveyed in the database have some sort of the regulations on spending, political spending. And then this seems to be a growing trend, but of course, oversight bodies need to actually monitor whether it's properly adhered to, actually. I mean, this is very important. And then, of course, its numbers increasing. But if you look into the 32%, of course, its situation is also more interesting, for example. So there's only currently, it comes to spending, only 3% of the countries have a specific spending limit on the online media advertisement. So, as we all know, given the recent use of the Facebook or Twitter, or even some scandals relating to fake news or online sources, the oversight bodies are increasingly aware how this could be properly managed and then regulated as well. So we also do receive a lot of questions as well as the inquiries from the countries. Electoral management bodies, and we see that there's no standard way of regulating at the moment. And as you also see that technology is advancing very rapidly, so the unfortunate truth is that regulations are a little bit lagging behind and a bit slow to react to the fast-changing technological world. But only 3% of them have regulations on online media advertisement. I mean, that itself is a very interesting finding. And then linking to the oversight, we like to think the oversight bodies may consider develop some type of strategies how this regulation spending can be monitored, for example, and then better regulated the spending by the political parties and candidates when it comes to the use of online sources.
And when you talk about oversight, how many countries have this kind of function?
Function as to the overseeing the point.
Yes.
I'm glad to report that about almost all countries have bodies responsible for overseeing political finance, but there's a very big variations. In some countries, and also growing trend as well, have a dedicated electoral management bodies. We call it EMBs, so that they are often the independent, dedicated agency who are tasked to monitor. And then also in some cases, they have some legal power to refer cases to prosecution, for example, in case of the misconduct. But in other countries, they do not necessarily have such independent bodies, and then oversight is in the hand of, in some cases, parliaments, or sometimes with the government ministries, or in some cases, the audit agencies as well. So there's no uniform way of overseeing the money in politics. But of course, we like to advocate, I mean, the depending on the country context, of course, but we like to think any financial public bodies whose task to oversee the political finance needs to be, to some extent, independent and has sufficient capacities, both human capacities and also budgetary capacities to conduct meaningful oversight. And oversight is a catch-all word, but if you think about it, it's a lot of work to develop policies and guidelines for political parties, but also actually audit and verify the financial reports, and also in case of the misconduct, I mean, who are actually going to investigate these cases. So it requires a lot of resources. But however, we like to think for any meaningful oversight, agencies needs to have both independence and appropriate capacities. And that's something any countries who are thinking about reforming their oversight mechanisms need to consider.
Yeah. No, and that's interesting because, I mean, otherwise you risk having a situation where you might have legislation, but it's not really implemented if you don't have a good oversight.
Exactly.
As a final point,
yes.
I wanted to ask you sort of what the future looks like and how to use the database and actually how the database is different, because I know this is a publication, it's getting a bit old. Could you explain a little bit?
Absolutely. So this report is the funding of political parties and election campaigns. It's one of our bestsellers, if I say so myself. But it's been published. It was published in 2016. And then this was based on the findings of the our own political finance database back then in after the 2016 update. So it's still 2 years old and a lot of findings are still valid. But however, after this 2018 update, I'm very pleased to announce that International IDEA is currently working on drafting a new set of policy papers based on the 2018 update. So we hope to bring some new, fresh issues on the table after this update. And then we like to link these findings to the very specific concrete proposals for action for political parties or electoral management bodies, or even for researchers, for CSOs and media as a sort of food for thought and moving forward. And also, for the use of 2018 or any database that we have, actually, it's important to actually say this outright, that we all know that the having political finance regulations or laws in place on paper does not always guarantee that those laws are implemented. We all know that according to the database, I'm happy to say most of the countries have some levels of some forms of political finance regulations in place already. But we all know that there are continuing scandals, and also in some countries those rules are not complied at all. Unfortunately, this database does not capture the level of compliance or the level of implementation in each country. So unfortunately, we do not know whether these laws that we have in the database are actually exercised. However, we think, and then based on the user feedback as well, I think it's important to have a collection of data set in one place, so that if a country or a researcher or media or anyone who's interested in money politics needs to know or are interested in knowing what other countries are doing, or like to compare what their countries perform vis-a-vis the their neighboring countries or other countries they're interested, this database will allow to do that. And then I hope with this database will serve to be the central source for information for those who are really interested in political finance and then like to see what other countries and global trends are.
Yeah, and you have a feedback function. So if anyone Absolutely. Finds a mistake or there's new
Exactly.
legislation in
Exactly.
the country,
Exactly.
you have a feedback function.
So yes, Lisa. So we're talking about a very big data set now. So we have 74 questions for 180 countries. We deployed a large number of researchers to verify those answers to the best of knowledge. But of course, the situations in each country are changing very rapidly, and some data can easily be outdated. So exactly, so there's a function in the database that you can submit directly your feedback to us, so that if any users have ever spotted such inaccuracies or any changes or new reform ideas or what have you, really, we'd be very interested to hear from the users, and then we consider the, each proposal or feedback carefully and then try to update the database as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you, Yuki. This has been really interesting for me.
No, thank you very much.
I want to thank everyone who's been watching, and you have the link to the database directly under the live stream, and we have been talking about money in politics. That's all for now.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Over there.